Welcome, friends, to this monthly meeting we have each month to get together. And as I explain almost every time, that the reason for these meetings is that when we are on a spiritual path, our minds being what they are, distract us so much that it is a good idea to get together and get back on track and get back to something that should be our first priority in human life. Human life is different from any other life. According to some scriptures, they say there are 8.4 million types of life forms in which souls can manifest themselves on this planet. Out of 8.4 million life forms, which includes plants, includes insects, include birds, mammals, it includes all types, includes angels, includes life forms at other levels of consciousness, all those included, only one form has been given the ability to feel that they have a free will to make a choice. All others just go according to a predetermined destiny set up for them. The human being thinks, I make my own destiny, I make my own choices, I can do what I like. This feeling that you can do what you like, you can plan and find what you want to do anytime, is only unique to human form. And that is why when we have a human form, it gives us the ability to do the most important thing in spiritual seeking, and that is to seek the truth within yourself. Our minds are designed to look for its activities and its pleasures and fulfill its desires outside. The mind is always using our sense perceptions to look outside. But there is something in us which wants to go beyond the mind. Something in us that wants to say, this is not it. This is not my place. It doesn't look like this is designed for me. And that something in us is our own conscious self, our own soul, our own spirit. It is that spirit that seeks the truth within itself. And this is possible in this human life, to become a seeker of the truth, a seeker of the ultimate. This desire to seek the ultimate is not unique to any one person. We all have it. It comes from a different part of our consciousness than what we normally employ in living in this world. When we live in this world, we are using our minds. We are thinking. Mind is a thinking machine. We are not thinking machines. We are conscious machines. We are conscious beings, and conscious beings housed in something that is looking like a human body and functions through sense perceptions and a thinking mind. This thinking mind is like a cover upon our own self. And the sense perceptions are also a cover. And so is the physical body. If we look very carefully how we are operating in this world, we can always see that we think the physical body is ourself because we are located inside it. And then we have sense perceptions, seeing, touching, tasting, smelling. All these are activities going on because we have sense organs and sense perceptions. Looks like they work because of our body, which is of course not true. If the sense perceptions were to work only with the body, we could never have dreams. We could never have visualizations. We could never imagine anything. The fact that we can imagine all the things that sense perceptions do means that sense perceptions are independent of the physical body. If you want to think of some place, we can think right now. That means these eyes don't see. Something else in us can also see. What can see, touch, taste, smell is a separate form of ourselves, built into this body and placed inside this body. We sometimes refer to it as the astral self. We call it the astral self because when we withdraw our attention from the physical body and go into that self, we can still see a sky, we can still see space and time, And therefore, it looks like there's another sky sitting inside us, and the word astral has been used for that reason. Sometimes we have called it sensory body, sometimes we have called it by other names. But the fact is that inside the physical body lies an independent and separate body. But that is not ourself either. It's just a body, like the physical body. If we were to go and examine that, which means become unconscious of the physical body, but remain fully conscious of what is inside, which is what we try to achieve through meditation upon the self. If we are able to examine that body, we find that body also has a birth and death, just like the physical body. Only its term is much longer. And therefore, if we are able to go to that state through meditation where we can see our inner self without having consciousness of the outer selves, we find that we can remember things, sensory things, our own sensations and experiences of several hundred years before we were born in this body, which means that that inner self has a longer life of its own, and yet it is housed in one physical body with a shorter life. Similarly, if we can go even further within ourselves and discover that the thinking mind can function on its own self, that perception is not actually a sensory experience at all. Sensory experiences are merely a division of perception into different senses. That the perception takes place through thought itself. That the mind that thinks can also perceive, and perceive fully without having to break down in seeing separately, hearing separately, and having other perceivable things separately. It can function as one separate perceiver, and on which it comments in language, in words or pictures. And that is what the mind is. The mind is constantly working. These things, the mind never stops because it is continuously working and thinking. If it stops thinking, it'll die. If the mind dies, sensory systems which are extending from the mind will also die. Physical body which is placed outside these two will also die. Everything will die. That is, these are, none of them are ourself. They're covers upon ourselves. Very useful covers. Very useful devices to have different levels of experiences. All these are operating simultaneously within us. And that is why we can think, we can see, touch, taste, smell, and we can walk with our physical bodies. All these are covers upon our own self, which is pure consciousness, the ability to be aware, the ability to be alive. The ability to be alive is ourself, not that we can think. Thinking is additional. Thinking is possible because we have also got, in addition to consciousness, a mind that thinks, and we use the mind to think and to speculate and to hope and to fear and to regret and to have guilt. Well, lots of things happening through the thought process. So all those things are built into the mind. The mind also does something so great, so unimaginable, that we can't even explain it today, that the mind creates the experience of space and time. We don't need this. This is just for experience. Why do we need so much vastness around us? Why do we need infinite time operating outside of us? It's only because the mind wants to place events outside and make it look like a real world living outside, and we are merely experiencing it. This ability to create a world outside and make that more real than your own self is an amazing feat by the mind. It's the most miraculous thing that has ever happened that I can possibly think of, that a thinking machine installed next to our consciousness should be able to create space and time and a whole creation outside, which, because of the nature of space and time being infinite, looks like we are merely small fries in a world that has been existing forever. It's a very big miracle that's happened. It does not look like that because we assume that the world is real and we are merely come for a short time, which means that we take our body to be ourselves because the body has come for a short time, and therefore we don't understand how it all works. But it is possible to see all these things. It is possible to investigate what I am saying now by a simple process of going within. Because all we are talking about is consciousness being surrounded by a mind. Consciousness and mind being surrounded by sense perceptions, and all that package being surrounded by a human body. Therefore, the secret to determine whether what I am saying is correct or not, anybody can verify. It does not depend on one's religion. It does not depend on one's belief system. It does not depend on anything except that you go within and check it out. That is why this path of discovering yourself is not confined to any particular religion or group or person. It's open to all human beings completely. There's no distinction whatsoever. You cannot say some people are qualified and some are not. All human beings are equally qualified, equally endowed, equally having the same thing that I'm talking about. It's not unique to anybody particular person. The only thing is that if we assume that the world is real and we live in this real world that we created outside, then this will remain a real world and we have no idea how we are experiencing it. The reverse can be done by withdrawing within our own self. Now that becomes a very difficult proposition, to go within ourselves, because we never gone within ourselves. We are using our own consciousness to experience what is outside. We don't experience anything that's inside. We have dreams, we place events of outside into our dreams. We have imagination, we imagine things that are outside. We don't think of anything inside. And we have done it not only for one lifetime. If we have previous lives, we have been doing it in every lifetime. And we have been now so accustomed to believing the existence of an outside world in which we appear for a short time and we go away. We don't know where we go away. Yesterday, somebody sent me a report of medical science. Some medical scientists who have been investigating for 20 years, seeing 50,000 of their subjects, and have come to the conclusion that consciousness appears to be outliving the human body. And they have studied near-death experiences, and they have studied several cases of people who could recall when they were physically, clinically, completely dead. They could recall events that were happening to them. So they have come to the belief that consciousness is something that is independent of this physical life and physical body. Which is the first time I've seen medical science even coming to this kind of a conclusion based upon the evidence produced by a large number of cases who were clinically dead with nothing operating, including the brain was dead, and they were resuscitated and they were able to recall what was happening during that period. Though such people were also able to tell what was going around their body, who was there, what they were doing, and those details. The fact that consciousness exists, they don't know where it goes when it dies. The medical science still thinks apparently it stays somewhere in the universe. That's what their conclusion is, that it stays somewhere in the universe and comes from the universe and goes into us and then probably stays somewhere. All religions speak about the immortality of our soul, that our real form is immortal. It's immortal means it was never born and never dies. But these other forms of covers upon ourselves, they are born and they die. The mind also has a life. The mind is not permanent. Mind also is born and dies. The sensory systems born and die. And the physical body is born and dies, with shorter and shorter period for the outer covers, so that with one mind we can have several forms of living. And this is, but this is speculation. The way to verify all these things is through deep meditation within ourselves. Now that is really shifting the whole art of using attention. Attention is a very useful thing, probably the most useful thing. If we did not have the power of putting attention on something, we would never have been able to discover who we are. The attention is part of awareness. Now, we are aware of this whole hall where we are sitting. We are aware. You are listening to me. Your attention is on what I am saying. I am talking to you. My attention is on you. I am not conscious at this time, or not aware at this time, what inside the doors are, where the other places are, because I am putting attention on something. So are you. Consciousness is the ability to be aware. It's a potential to be aware. It's always available. And we can be potentially aware of one thing or another, or close down awareness of one thing and open up another. But awareness is what is around us of which we are aware. It can be awareness of just in the mind that there's another city into which we belong from where we came. Or it can be awareness of what we are physically seeing around us with the eyes. Attention is picking up something out of awareness and just confining yourself to that part. When we read a book, we put our attention on the book, which means at that time we don't want to think of anything else except what is on the book. This ability of attention to be focused on something is a very great gift to us. I think as a gift given to human being, it's the greatest, according to me. Without attention, we would be just living a state of drift. Now I can see the trees growing outside. And I believe that the trees, as they grow, they can also feel what is around them. But there is no power of attention to focus anywhere. On the other hand, human beings can turn around and say, I want to only look at this thing, or I want to look at something else. This power of attention is what gives us the ability to seek something wherever we like. And we have been using this power of attention to be placed upon our experiences outside all our life. We have used attention as something that flows from within ourselves through the sense perceptions outside and get contact with experiences outside. We have never used this attention to withdraw and say, where is it coming from? Where is the point from which attention is flowing out from? If we were just to contemplate this, we can close our eyes, because obviously it's coming from inside our head, our body. If we close our eyes, which is the first place from where we make contact with the world outside, if we close our eyes and our ears and sit still and look inside, we find that we are aware that our consciousness can move, looking at the darkness in front, looking at little colors in front, still looking in front. Can we turn it around to look at itself? We have never done it. If we had done it to look at itself, we would have got answers to all these questions that I am raising here. We would have got answers by turning attention upon our own self. True meditation is the art of withdrawing attention to your own self. When you do that, the first thing that happens is that you find that your imaginary self, which you can always imagine inside, that you are imagining you're flying, you are imagining you're going somewhere, that imaginary self is also being generated by the same self which is generating the outside self. And that is why it's a good step to go within yourself. So when you go into an imaginary self of yours with your eyes closed and say, that is me and not the physical body, which is now with eyes closed and is not even looking outside, and the imaginary self then tries to look within itself, the next step, then you will find that you can disassociate even your sense perceptions from your own self. Very big step. Very few have taken. Although this teaching is available and even books have been written on it and doctrines have been established based on this, religions have been established based on this reality of our inside, and yet nobody practices it. The practice of focusing things away from yourself has become so rigid in us that even when we want to say, who am I inside, we close our eyes, we have to make a picture of ourselves in front of us, little realizing the picture of ourselves that we are trying to make in meditation or otherwise is not ourselves, but the one looking at the picture. Our reality is the observer, never the observed. And we are constantly looking at what is being observed, including feeling that we are observing ourselves by making something away from the observer. To turn around to the observer and not to what is being observed is a great art, takes a lot of time because we never done it. Needs practice. Therefore, true meditation is not that easy as we think it is, because true meditation is to withdraw our attention to where the attention is flowing from, to the self. And the self is neither the body, nor what we are seeing, nor our thinking machine. When we start thinking, you're already away from the self. Thoughts are external to the self. We think in front and around us. We don't think within us. And that is why it is not possible even by thinking to discover who we are. To be able to observe thoughts, to be able to see what the thoughts are and then realize who is really observing the thoughts. Thoughts are being created by the mind. We don't create thoughts. We have a machine to do it. The machine is called the mind. We use the mind to create thoughts. Do we observe the thoughts and then say, who is observing these thoughts? If we go to that level of introspection and going within ourselves, we'll come very close to who we are. We are pure consciousness, the ability to use all these things around us by putting our own power of getting awareness of the mind, of the senses, of the body. We are what creates life. We are what creates all our experiences at every level. So true meditation is not easy. Also, there has to be something to pull us within to our own self. Do we function independently of our thoughts? When we are sitting here in a physical body, do we have any experiences which are not related to the physical body or to the sense perceptions or to thoughts? Do we have any kind of experience we all normally sitting here have? Yes, we have some experiences directly from the consciousness, from the soul, where mind is not involved, senses are not involved, and the body is not involved. The first experience I can think of is when we experience love for somebody. Where does this come from? Not from thoughts. When we think, we often destroy that experience. And when we don't think, it's just there. Love is an experience. It's a spiritual experience coming from the spirit and does not occur in time and space. The mind tries to place it in time and space and make it relatable to something outside. But love is a function of the spirit itself. It comes instantaneously without apparent cause. It does not even follow the law of cause and effect. It just comes when it wants to come and comes from within our own self, true self. Similarly, sometimes we have an intuitive feeling, a hunch. This is going to happen. I don't know why. I can't explain it, but I know it. Where does that knowledge come from? That sudden knowing is also directly a spiritual experience and is not connected with thought, not connected with sense perception, not connected with the body. So even while we are here, we are having several types of experiences which could be called physical, that be relatable to the body, which could be called sensory, because the body is not involved and you can still imagine them, which could be called thinking, because you can think about anything with the mind, and which are occurring without thoughts, like intuition, love, appreciation of beauty, sudden appreciation. All those things come all the time. All levels of our self are working together. It's not separate. Some people think, I don't know how that thought crawled up, that these are different stages through which we go. That there is a physical stage, then we go up to the astral stage, then we go up to the causal stage, then we go up to a spiritual stage. The mind loves this concept of stages. The mind loves anything that we placed in a certain order. But these are not functioning in any order at all. They're all functioning together, simultaneously. We can, however, separate them as an experience by withdrawing our attention from one of them to the other. That's possible, but does not mean that they are operating independently at different stages. They're all in one stage, and there's only one stage of existence, the stage where we are truly conscious and adding on all these experiences to ourselves. There are no such levels that we have to cross from one sky to the other. That is why when people pray and look up at the sky, I wonder what are they finding? Somebody living up in the sky. Many people think God lives in the sky. They have to look up. No, it's everything is within. Outside is a creation from within. So how can anything be outside? We have to go within and not outside anywhere. So when we look at all these abilities that we have, that we can withdraw attention, and with guided proper meditation, we can withdraw. We can have certain experiences of shutting down some awarenesses. For example, we actually shut down the awareness of our human body every night when we go to sleep. But we are not really shutting down our own self. We are not shutting down consciousness. We go into a dream state. Sometimes we go into a deeper dream state which we cannot recall ever. And most of the dreams that we have fade away when we wake up within the first 30 seconds. When I came to the United States first time, there used to be a number of sleep institutes studying dreams and sleeps, and I joined them to see what they found out about sleeping and dreaming. So I understood a lot about dreaming, that each one of us dreams several times every night, and we don't remember 99.9% of our dreams. We dream every few minutes, and then there's a gap. It looks like a gap. The reason they think it's a gap is because they're studying only with the physical evidence of rapid eye movement, that when the rapid eye movement is taking place, that is when we are dreaming. And when it's not taking place, you're not dreaming. Actually, if you go and analyze this further, you're dreaming all the time. Just when you're not aware of the physical body, you're using another dream body to have those experiences. It's very interesting to see that they've observed during those experiments, they would put cameras to see the rapid eye movement. And from the rapid eye movement and the bodily movement during sleep, they would capture that we are moving bodily, trying to associate this physical body with what we are dreaming about. And the eyes are the one, the eyelids and the eyes are the one that flip-flop a lot during dreaming process. And that is why they use the REM or rapid eye movement as a means of checking out whether they're dreaming or not. They would also see that the eye movement, the rapid eye movement, was sometimes up and down, sometimes sometimes this side, sometimes this side. They would wake up the patient, wake up the subject at night and say, what were you dreaming? Well, they were saying the eyelids were moving like this. We are seeing a waterfall. We were going falling down. We were having something vertical in the dream. And what were you doing when the eyes were moving like this? You're watching a tennis match. You're watching sports, something like that. So the eyelids were moving. The physical body was showing something going on inside, which was a dream state. It does not mean that we never lose awareness of our body. We lose it every night. But there's a difference. When we lose awareness of the body, without maintaining our conscious awareness at the level of wakefulness, then we are not even aware what's happening. The dream becomes our only reality for a short time. We wake up, the dream fades away. What if you could hold the attention at the wakeful level and have the same experience? What if you're awake and you could go and not be aware of the body? Would it be the same? No, it wouldn't be. Then the experience would be of a state of being where you are more awake than you are awake now. In the case of the dream state, you are less awake than you are awake in the physical self. To be more awake than this, you have to sustain your wakeful state. Now this is something very interesting. We have observed that the notional point where we think we exist inside the body shifts all the time. Right now, when we are awake and we want to know where are we sitting, most likely we would say we are sitting in the head behind the eyes from where we're looking out at the world. Now, when we go to sleep, what happens? Do we still feel we are behind the eyes? No. We feel we're going down. And this can be tested by anybody. When you're very sleepy, about to sleep at night, do a little experiment. And that is, in the wakeful state, if you want to touch your eyes with your hands, you can close your eyes and touch. You know where the eyes are. You can know where you are. When you are feeling very sleepy, try to touch your eyes. You touch your nose and you think you're touching your eyes. Which means your own notion of where you are in the body has shifted downwards. The truth is, if you can really be conscious and experiment in the dream state, you are in the throat level. You drop like this. And when you wake up, you come up like this. That means there's a movement of your notional self within the body. It goes down. And therefore, you are not able to be equally awake like you are awake when you are behind the eyes. But if you were to meditate and withdraw attention and get into a state of unawareness of the body, you do not go below that. And therefore, it's a super wakefulness. It's a higher wakefulness than you are having now. And that's a great experience. It needs practice. It needs practice not to go to sleep during meditation, but to meditate with the power of attention, using the power of attention to be placed behind the eyes and concentrate to such an extent that you do not lower the notional point where you are and yet you become unaware of the body. That's when you have an experience of super wakefulness, higher wakefulness than the physical wakefulness. What does higher wakefulness do? Higher wakefulness, first of all, tells you that you have a world which is different from this world around you. It also gives you a contact with your own mental memory, and you can remember things which you don't remember right now in this physical state at all. This physical state, we can't even remember what we ate for breakfast last year or last month or sometimes even yesterday. And a guy like me, absent-minded guy like me, can't remember what I had this morning. So this is our state of memory here. But you find that your memory is awakened to a much greater degree just by forgetting you have a body and thinking you are that which is inside, and you can remember things. Not only that, you can find that experiences of that level are different. Have you ever imagined that if you were to close your eyes and think that you are the imaginary self there, you can fly, you can do what you like, you don't fall, you have no weight. Have you ever imagined that you have no weight when you are thinking of yourself inside? Inside body, the one that's created only by perception and not by physical body, has no weight and can fly anytime, anywhere. If you were to withdraw attention at the wakeful state to super wakefulness, you will find that's an actual fact. That you have the ability to fly and go wherever you like. And there are experiences which will keep you in touch with the world you have seen outside with physical eyes and the world you are seeing inside. And that overlap of an experience is remarkable. That you can have a contact with another world that opens up by super wakefulness. And then there's a world which is looking here. And you see the overlap and see how these things that you are seeing outside here are not creating your imagination inside, but what you thought was imaginary and is not really imaginary was what sustained the experience you were having outside. That you could see the people you see here are all extensions and copies coming up from outside, just like the dreams that we have. Our dreams, which are a copy from the physical experience we have here. The physical experience is being created the same way. Now, these are things which can be verified by proper meditation. Meditation is the art of going within, beyond these levels that have been surrounding our consciousness. Meditation does not end there. It takes us further. It takes us beyond. It takes us into a state where you can even forget all the sense perceptions and have direct perception and see that the whole thing, seeing, touching, tasting, smelling, all comes at once. In one go through the mind. The mind has that capacity. We don't use that capacity right now because of the covers upon it, and we operate through the covers, physical body and the sensory system. So that is why when we go within to the mind, then we discover something most remarkable, unbelievable completely, that the mind is setting up what we call our destinies at both other levels. when we say, yeah, we make our own destiny because we have a choice. No, you make your destiny because you have a mind. Your mind makes the destiny at another level, not here. If you are making a destiny here, you should be able to change everything right now what you are looking at. You can change nothing. You have to seek, work hard to make little changes here. But the mind makes the entire destiny there. In fact, it has a choice of making so many destinies, so many infinite destinies, it just picks up a destiny and creates all astral and physical life from there. Now to have that a personal experience, very few people have it. Unfortunately, whereas everybody can have it, very few have it because nobody ever tries to go to that state. Now these are achievable things. You can achieve them with effort, with meditation, putting time on it, and giving it enough time to practice. You can achieve these and verify these things personally, that they actually exist the same way for everybody. It's not that one person's imagination is creating something, somebody's imagination creating something else. The way these things operate, the levels of consciousness are the same. But still we have not found ourselves. If the search is for our true self, for the truth, if we want to find what are the origin of all experiences, this will not give you that. It will only show you how these systems, physical system with a material world, an astral system with a sensory world, and a causal system which causes all these things in the mental world, they operate. You can discover that. You still do not discover yourself. There is no way anybody by any effort can ever discover oneself. And why I say that is because all effort, no matter how, what kind of effort, is made with the mind. Your mind has to decide, I want to do this. I want to try this. There you are bound by the rules of the mind. You cannot go beyond. Something should be available to us. If self-realization is an actual possibility, something real should be available to us to realize the self. And that availability is that something that is beyond the mind can pull us through all these levels and pull us beyond the mind. Only that can be pulling us beyond the mind, which exists beyond the mind. I just mentioned that love, intuition, appreciation of beauty, these things happen immediately without time and space in this physical life. They also happen like that inside. That which can pull us beyond the mind is the power of love. Because love does not operate from the mind. If there is love flowing and drawing us beyond the mind, we can be pulled through the mind and beyond. How can we find that love exists beyond the mind? We exist beyond the mind, definitely. Because we are using a mind in addition to being conscious ourselves. If pure consciousness is using the mind, how can we find that there is love drawing us from within ourselves? We are separated from our own self through the mind. We don't think that our ultimate aim is ourselves. We say we want to find God. We don't want to say we find ourselves, which was God, is God, is operating like that. We don't think like that. We separated ourselves. Therefore, in this state of separation, where we have separated ourselves from that which we are beyond the mind, to where we have become a seeker of our own self now, we find the pull has to come from the other side. Now, there has been arrangement for those who want to seek something beyond the mind, those who want to discover the self beyond the mind, those who want to discover the origin of all experiences. An arrangement has been made that there are people already beyond the mind who were pulled by another person beyond the mind, and their love alone pulled us beyond the mind. Such people we call perfect living masters. I found one in my life, or maybe I found, his picture is right here, you can see behind me. This man had that experience of being pulled beyond the mind by another master another perfect living master, who loved him from beyond, and the love was pulling him beyond his thoughts and beyond his mind, beyond his body. When we are seeking that, and this is something outside, arranged by our own mind, we have created a universe outside, from inside. The blueprint of this universe is inside, not outside at all. When we can create that, can we not create something, if our seeking is so strong, can we not create something that should give us the experience of going beyond the mind? Yes, we do. We create another human being in our own experience. We create a human being who become independent of us, as separate from us, and therefore we are willing to listen because we listen to everything outside. And such a human being created in our life, who is operating while he is here in a human form, from beyond the mind, his love will flow from beyond the mind, and his love will pull us beyond the mind. The role of a perfect living master, according to what I am describing, the role of a perfect living master is not to teach us anything, is not to give any discourses on anything. His role is to pull us when we are seeking. We have arranged it. We have arranged to have an experience which will come outside, because we are only looking outside. We'll have an experience of a human being coming outside whose love pulls us beyond the mind, that even thoughts cannot explain that love. That the love pulls in such a strange way because it's not used to our mental way of looking at things. That love pulls us beyond the mind. When we are seekers of that truth, such a person comes into our life automatically. We can't seek that person. We can seek the truth. When we seek the truth inside, such a person coincidentally appears outside. It's arrangement. This means we are not completely shut off from the ability to discover who we are. What do we need to do to have that experience? Seek for something beyond the mind. Seek for true love. Seek for true beauty, true bliss, true of those things which we associate. We think that is what we ought to be. That's what we really might be. That's what we are, and not what we think seeing outside in this world. When your seeking is of that type, of course, if you seek, I have to have better health, you'll get from somewhere here. You want to seek more money, it'll come from here. Seek other things of physical or mental type, you'll get them here. But when you seek the truth, which is beyond all these things, and your seeking is not for any of these things, but beyond that, such a person will definitely appear in your life through coincidence. That's the role of a perfect living master, to draw us above the mind. But while human being and sitting here, we like to be operating with our mind, operating, trying to judge everything with the mind. We are very judging people. That's one thing that has happened by overuse of the mind. We become judgmental. We judge everything constantly. We're judging because we have a mind that can judge, that can evaluate. And therefore, we are judging constantly. We ought to judge if such a human being is the right person or not. We can spend a whole life on that only. But in spite of all our judgment, what can override the judgment is the powerful love that we experience from such a person. Therefore, the person who comes to take us beyond the mind functions with us like a mind, like an ordinary person. Love involves some kind of a relationship which could be called true friendship. I can't find better words how to associate with a person whose pure love is attracting us somehow as real pure friendship. Therefore, I say, if such a person who comes into our life is not a friend of ours, forget about love. Friendship and love will go together. Friendship is something that can be used at every level. We can associate with somebody physically and talk to each other and be friendly. We can be friendly in our thoughts. We can be missing somebody so much. Friendship continues at every level. Love comes from consciousness, from our own true self. Therefore, such a person who comes and who I call a perfect living master. And why do I call him a perfect living master? Why these words? Because all imperfection is at the level of the mind and below. There's no imperfection above that. Duality creates imperfection. Duality is created only by the mind. When you don't have time, space and divisions, there is no duality. And therefore, in a non-dual state, we do not have imperfection. And that is why a person who, while he is alive, like ourselves, and who can talk to us like any one of us, who can live life just like ours, life, who is no different from us, and therefore can be a friend, such a person can be the right person who can also be a perfect living master. If he cannot be a friend, he cannot be a perfect living master for us. Friendship can start right from any level and go on all the way back. So what happens? That since we are functioning with our minds, such a person who is perfect, living, because we can deal with him and he can give us answers to our questions. A living person can tell us, no, what you're thinking is not right. Supposing the person is not living, a dead perfect living master, he cannot give any answers to our questions. When we say no, we can manifest him inside. You are manifesting nothing but your own mind. All manifestation inside is your own mind creating it. There's no way you can manifest anything except through the mind. It's a very big mistake some people make, thinking, oh, we are finding some great masters operating from the Himalayas. They're coming from far east from there. I have been to the Himalayas. I didn't see any one of them communicating with people who say we are communicating with those people there. This is all manifestation with the mind. We have not crossed the mind at all with any of those experiences. We are just fooling ourselves thinking that the mind can make up the truth beyond the mind. It cannot. When we say, do we get an answer to our question inside? The mind answers. The mind likes to answer what you want to hear. But you do not cross the mind. The mind's desire is to enjoy and have pleasures outside. It's built into it. It is built for the sake of coming over here and to maintain the duality of this experience. Pleasure and pain were put together. So therefore, the mind cannot really answer our questions at all. And yet the mind answers questions if a person is not alive. A live person can give an answer and say, your mind is making a mistake. The mind won't say that. That is why a perfect living master. Why do we call him master? He's only mastered the ability to go beyond the mind. That's it. So that is why I call such a human being who, while he's with us, moving around like an ordinary person like us, he is still perfect, having his awareness, his consciousness is available to him at all times, even when he's in a physical body, unlike us, who are shut down from one level of consciousness to another and only live now in physical consciousness. And we can sometimes go to one higher consciousness or still higher or lower. We go into lower consciousness while dreaming. Through meditation, we can go to higher consciousness, but we are still trapped. A person who lives with us like ourselves and has been created specifically to appear in our life when we are seeking something beyond the mind. That's when he appears. When he appears, we are seeking for the truth beyond our own minds. And that is how such a person comes. Why should he be completely ordinary? He should have something about him that should say that he is extraordinary. He is extraordinary in the awareness he has. That's obvious. We can't see it. We can't see where the awareness of another person is. But the extraordinariness of an ordinary person who becomes perfect living master is his awareness of levels beyond the mind, which he carries with him while even he is sitting with us in a physical form. That's the beauty of this experience, that there are such human beings who are ordinary, more ordinary than more ordinary people, and yet they are carrying an awareness which is beyond the mind. And from where they operate, in dealing with those who are marked as seekers for whom they have appeared. They have not appeared just to give a universal message to the world. There are thousands of people who have come and given a lot of good messages to the world. These perfect living masters come individually for a seeker for whom they have appeared in their life. And that is why it's so unique an experience. Can we find such persons? Never. People try to find, which is a good sign. Trying to find means you are a seeker. Trying to find is a good thing because you are a seeker. But when they appear is when you are ready. And what is the state of readiness when they should appear? The state of readiness is when the mind, having fought the battles of the ups and downs of this world, has said, this is not my place. Even if it is, I am fed up of it. I want to go back to my true home. I want to go where I belong. When that kind of thing comes, you're ready. And this readiness, you know your readiness. But if the desires are still trying to pull you here, not ready yet. Therefore, when the desire is for the truth, and you are tired of trying these things here, tired, completely fed up, this is not the place for me. I don't want to be here. I want to go to my true home. When those kinds of strong feelings come, such a person will appear in your life because you are ready. And that person will know you are ready instantly when he's seeing you, and we will know only from our own feeling that this is not our place. That person will come into your life and act like an ordinary person, ordinary friend, but with a strange power of pull of love, which can't be explained by reason. Reason fails when love comes like that. We try to reason, which creates something else called sometimes a doubt, sometimes fear. Fear is generated by doubt. If there's no doubt, there's no fear. So doubt and fear come together. The mind practices doubt and fear all the time. This is a good gift given to us, to have a doubt and to fear. Because otherwise, we'd be just taken advantage of anybody who comes and says anything. We just believe everybody. The doubt and fear makes us skeptics, which gives us a chance to go beyond just being pulled by anybody, but only by pulled by somebody who overrides even our doubts and fears. Ultimately, love overrides even doubts and fears. But doubt and fear is a good screen. It's a good screen for us not to jump to conclusions at once. So that is why this system operates like that. During the relationship with such a human being, our doubts and fears come, and they overcome gradually. Sometimes they are overcome very quickly, sometimes gradually. Sometimes we need strange kind of experiences which look miraculous to us. You say, there must be something going on. That they look against the law of probability. Improbable things, when they happen, we begin to think there's something going on here. They're just hints that something is going on here. And then we begin to associate with that human being. There's something he is doing, the way he has come, things have started happening. People say coincidence is no accident, and I believe it. Coincidence is not an accident. It's a language of the universe and is equivalent to intuition. You have an intuitive feeling outside, and coincidence takes place outside. Intuition inside, coincidence outside. I can have very strong intuitive feeling one morning about something going to happen, and I drive my car out and see a hoarding. Nothing grew. It's advertising a shampoo or something. But two words there are matching what my intuition said. Say, how can that be? What kind of coincidence is this? These are matching things in our internal and external experience that begins to tell us something is going on. It's not something that happens suddenly overnight. It takes a long time for a number of these things to happen. Not only in one lifetime. They can happen in several lifetimes before we are really ready and say, we want to go to our true home. It's a long process through which we go because we have been experiencing outside for a long time. And the time comes when we are ready to go home, and that's when these things happen. What does a perfect living master do whose only role is to pull us with his love beyond the mind? He only comes for that, but he becomes a friend. He becomes a counselor. He becomes a teacher. He begins to do everything that our mind wants so that our relationship is sustained and takes us over these At the end, we want nothing of those teachings. We have nothing of what he has been saying except his love that pulls us. That's how a perfect living master operates in this life. It's a unique experience to have an experience with a perfect living master. I was so fortunate that I had that experience and I can share it with you. I can share these things because these work. I would be a total hypocrite if I were to come and say something that I've read in a book and explain it to you. That'll be useless for me. I'd never do it. Only when I see that something has actually worked that I can share with you. And that is why I'm so strong about it, that this thing actually works. It's not a theoretical model put up. Of course, at one time I thought like that. I thought maybe it's just a big story made up by these people, and we call them masters, and we call them gurus, and we call them, they're all their own, all in a big, conspiracy going on by these people, and just to fool us, sometimes to make money out of us, sometimes to exploit us, and therefore it's all made up by these people. I used to think like that. But the very sequence of things that I'm mentioning to you, the coincidences and all that, led to a point. Even after I had accepted him as my guru, I was still very skeptic for many years. I didn't believe. I said, it's just a chance happening I met this guy. Maybe I could have met a better guy. Maybe I could meet somebody who has more knowledge than him. And I investigated. I think I met more gurus than anybody I know. I met more masters than anybody I know. I tried more types of meditation than anybody I know. I tried everything. Only after that I came to the conclusion, let me give a fair trial to what this man is saying. And it works. That is why I'm basing all the things I say. It's based upon an experience I've had with this man. Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh, great master. We call him great master. Everybody calls him great master. He was great because he shared such intense love from the soul. Soul pulling the soul was actual experience. And that is what the real experience is all about. It is a spiritual experience. The spiritual path is a spiritual experience, not a mental experience. We are having mental experiences all the time. We can have mentally, we can make up heavens, we can make up anything in the mind and have an experience of that. Remember, all experiences are external to ourselves. The experiencer is not experience. At any time. Experience can be generated. It does not give you knowledge of the experiencer. Self-realization is to know the experiencer, not the experience, no matter how high it is, no matter how wonderful it is. We are always being fooled by experience and saying we reached self-realization because we had that particular experience. An experience is not ourselves. It's an external to ourselves. Even if it is experience of our true home, of such kind, it's an experience. It's not knowledge of the self. That is why, if you want to know who you are, it's the greatest discovery who you are. You are the creator of every possible thing, including God. You are what has been called the original, nameless thing which we can't name, but we still call it the Word. John in his gospel in the opening verses says, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God and the Word was God. How can you describe any other way? How can you describe that what we think as a creative power is also coming from something that's beyond it? And that's the self. Ultimate self. Only one. There's no division there. And it is experienceable while we are human beings and seekers. Can you imagine the potential for finding something as human beings of that level, that everything can be found. There's nothing beyond our ability to find. Everything can be found, and yet the mistake is we are looking outside to find, not inside. The deeper you go inside, the more you will find. You will find what is outside by going inside. You will find how outside is created by going inside. The secret is all going within, inside. This is a great opportunity we have. This opportunity doesn't come all the time, I can tell you. Human life is not as common as we think. It's we are trapped here. As human beings, we are trapped by a network which has been created by the mind. A network which we are so trapped, we can't get out. It's like worse than a spider's web and the flies that get caught into it. And the network that catches us is that we believe there's no difference between the mind and ourself. When we say, I think, that's yourself. The thought process is generated by you, the self, which is not true. But that's where the error comes in, and then the mind takes control of everything. And the mind has a certain law. It operates here. Very useful law, very beautiful law, very wonderful you examine it. The law of cause and effect. The law that places events in an order in which one is a cause, another is an effect. What happens with that cause and effect? That creates what is called the law of karma. Do good, get rewarded. Do bad, get punished. That law holds us here. No matter who we are, so long as we are born in this physical world, we are governed by the law of cause and effect. Do good, get rewarded. Do bad, get punished, stay here forever. You don't get out from here. Do all the good you can. Okay, we'll take you to a very nice place. Not physical, we'll take you to an astral place called heaven. You've done so much good, 3 months in heaven. After 3 months, back here. This is what is the real trap. The real trap is this cause and effect, the law of karma, which is not real at all for us. The soul has no karma whatsoever, never had, never will. Yet by associating itself, identifying itself with the mind, gets into the cause and effect law and gets trapped here. There is no way by our own effort we can ever get out of this law, because the law is being administered by our own mind. Our own mind determines what is good and bad. Our own mind determines its reward and punishment. And we go through it. No escape, because what is good and bad, what is the law of karma, is set not here. It is set in our minds at a causal level. We come with it and believe in it and work on it. Then there are outside agencies that guide us. Most of them are now called religions. They tell us what is good, what is bad. There are other moral societies. We are all, even atheists are governed by cause and effect. It's not a question of belief system at all. Cause and effect is there whether you believe it or not. One man said, I don't believe in karma. Okay, then you never fall sick. No, I did fall sick. That's because of my health, bad health. Cause and effect does not let us get out of here at all. And the only way is to go beyond the mind if you want to experience something that is beyond cause and effect. To be able to see that the whole thing, the whole set of experiences, including experiences of cause and effect, are being generated as an experience for consciousness. Just to generate it is not real. Looks real, made real. We wanted to have real experience. We did a successful job, very successful job, to create something from the mind and make it real. By shutting yourself off and looking outside, it's all real. So that is why such a beautifully executed job. And yet, at a certain point in time, we are fed up of our own creative work that we have done. Time to stop and go back home. And that is when a perfect living master comes coincidentally into our life. The rest is all done. Our mind cannot believe that our effort and journey ends when a perfect living master comes and accepts us as a friend in our life. Mind doesn't believe that. Mind thinks our journey has started. Now we start serious meditation. Now we have to do all this. The perfect living master watches. Okay, go ahead. You have to exhaust your mind. You have to find out that there's something beyond the mind. The best way to find out beyond the mind is to exhaust your mind. Meditate so much, so hard. See, it doesn't work. You go to a perfect living master and tell him, I worked so hard on my meditation. I don't get anything real. I just get some sparkling stars and some things. I sometimes see I'm flying, but I don't get anything. And we think the perfect living master will get alarmed and say, oh, I'm sorry to hear that. No, he smiles. He's very happy. He's very, very happy to find out that the mind cannot go beyond that. He's very happy that you are exhausting your mind and finding out mind cannot deliver what you have come for, what you're seeking. So that is why we are looking at this whole life topsy-turvy, thinking that we are trapped outside, we have to go in. No, we are creating outside and we are trapped in that creative activity of the mind. That's where we are trapped. And we have to get out of it by getting out of the whole system, which is mental, going beyond the mind. And the perfect living masters come into our life to pull us with his subtle love, which is operating from inside us beyond the mind. He's not outside. A master looks outside, looks to be a human being outside. But on the true spiritual side of things, he is operating inside, never outside. Outside is because we don't look inside. If we had the ability to look inside whenever we wanted, if that was the way the universe was created, no master would appear outside, would appear inside. But we don't look inside, we look outside. Therefore, he appears outside. But later on, we find he's been operating all the time from inside. Finally, we find he was no other than our own self, trying to find our own true home. But this whole arrangement has been made like this, that while we are sitting in this creation, created world, that he appears outside for us. I'm very happy that you came today, and I'll see you for a few minutes later in the afternoon. Have a lunch break or a snack break, what is here. Then see you again. Thank you.